Well, good evening, everybody. This is Dave Brigley with Making the Play, and tonight we have episode 27, and we'll be continuing our discussion from a few weeks back. We have some young entrepreneurs on, and with us tonight are PremikaPandia and Kendall Furbee. Ladies, are you with us?
Yeah.
Excellent. And if you'll recall from about a few weeks ago, this started something I came across back in the spring, realizing at the University of Illinois, the school I went to that I'm very proud of, they have a incubator for entrepreneurs who want to do startup companies. And the more I read, the more I got interested, and we had a couple guests on a couple weeks ago with Therapals. And tonight, these ladies will be telling us about themselves and their startup, which is called Cut to the Case. So with that, I'm going to turn it over to the two of you and tell us a little bit about your personal stories.
Yeah, so I'm Kendall Furbee, and I'm a junior in materials engineering here at the University of Illinois. I first became involved in startups with Maker Girl, and that's actually where I met Premika. But that's where I kind of fell in love with entrepreneurship and startups, and then I was involved in Cast 21, and then from there, Premika and I started Cut to the Case.
And I'm Premika. So yeah, I met Kendall through Maker Girl. We actually traveled across the country in a trailer together for 2 months, and we started talking about how we wanted to start our own company, and that's not something that I would have thought of doing if I hadn't been involved with the startup community here at U of I.
And why don't you, again, go a little more in depth about that group, what that community and where it's coming from, because I've really had the pleasure of talking with several of, it's hard to call you classmates, but your colleagues, your beyond classmates, and hearing the things they want to do, and it's just been fun, to say the least, just to hear what you all are up to. But tell us a little bit about iVenture and other groups that you've been with.
Yeah, so iVenture is a startup incubator specifically for students at the University of Illinois, and they give you an entire summer to work on your startup, $10,000 of funding, and access to a ton of really great mentors, as well as professors and resources on campus to really help you grow your ideas. And the whole point is so students can get involved with more than just your typical route of internships or jobs and can explore other options.
And what about Maker Girl? Because I was actually just telling my youngest daughter, who is 12 going on 13, about Maker Girl. I find that to be a really, really interesting venture the two of you are in. And I'd like to hear a little bit about this trailer the two of you were traveling across the country in.
Yeah, so Maker Girl is a nonprofit organization that aims to get girls involved in STEM education. So STEM, science, technology, engineering, math. I think they just made it STEAM. So science, technology, engineering, art, and math. So we would hold 3D printing sessions for girls around the ages of 7 to 10 to encourage them to get involved in science fields. So Premika and I, we did the first Maker Girl Goes Mobile trip. So we helped raise funding through Kickstarter campaigns and in-kind donations in order to get, fund that trip. And then for 2 months, we were on the road from coast to coast, taking these 3D printing sessions mobile and specifically targeting rural and disadvantaged communities.
Excellent. And with now, I would like to really get back to, you know, your particular project. Cut to the Case, a little bit of an overview. How did you come to this topic? And because it is a deep one, I'll let you explain what it is. But I'd really like to, it's very different from Maker Girl, again, from 3D printers to this topic here on accountability, transparency, reporting for sexual assaults.
Yeah, so I think the main thing that we really wanted to accomplish was to work on something that we were both really passionate about. And when it came down to it, as women on a university campus, sexual assault is a huge issue. And it's something that we've seen occur a lot. We get crime alerts way too often about someone being sexually assaulted. And we realized that we really wanted to do something to kind of solve that issue. And it's also an issue that doesn't necessarily get talked about a lot. So that's how Cut to the Case came around, just out of the need for it and our passion coming from wanting to fix this issue.
And it's definitely in the news right now. Hollywood has definitely put, with the hashtag MeToo that's out right now, there's definitely more attention on it. And unfortunately, you have to wonder if the attention will die down at some time from this peak right now where it's going. Hopefully it won't, because I think, as a lot of the listeners know, I have four teenage daughters. One is her sophomore year at college. And I ask her about, you know, is it safer? She's walking with friends, things like that. She's in a big city. I'm very familiar with the campus of University of Illinois. It's a, you like to think it's a safe place. And as a guy, you definitely have a very different view than women will, walking late at night on a big, big campus like that with 45,000 students. Why is it, why, in your opinion, why is this topic not getting enough tension, especially on campus?
I think a huge problem is that a lot of, half the population doesn't see it as a problem because they don't face it. So a lot of men or guys that we talk to at the university kind of didn't understand why we would maybe feel unsafe walking around on campus. I know personally, like, I live pretty far from the building where most of my classes are, and when it's like 1 a.m. and I'm walking and I have to decide whether I want to stay longer or walk home, then I always want to get home faster. But my classmates, who are predominantly male, will stay behind until 3 a.m. and then walk home without any fear of anything happening to them. So I think part of it is definitely that people don't realize it's a problem. And the other part is that people don't like talking about sexual assault because it's something that scares them. And it's something that they don't want to think other people are capable of doing.
Why don't they want to believe that someone else is capable of that? We see it in the movies. We see it in the paper. It's everywhere. Why wouldn't we want to believe it?
I think specifically on college campuses, a lot of sexual assaults and rapes that occur are acquaintance rapes. So it's not even like what you see in movies where it's like a scary, like you're in a dark alley and you get assaulted by someone you don't know. A lot of times it's someone that the person does know on a college campus. So I think that idea kind of makes it like a whole different ball game.
Definitely. And what do you say to those who would say, well, why don't they just report it?
I think coming forward is really difficult because as a society, we're not good about responding well to victims. So I think when people do come forward, it often ends up being that they aren't believed or they're doubted, and people kind of question the truth of their narrative. And these people who maybe don't want to report hear from other victims that have that it didn't go well for them, so they kind of are scared too. And that's something we found over the summer too. When we were doing research, we called a bunch of advocacy centers and support hotlines, and a lot of them even told us, like, when you report, don't expect there to be any consequences for the perpetrators. Don't expect people to believe you. Like, when you report, it's for you, not necessarily because anything will happen. And for a lot of people, reporting isn't necessarily the option that would help them heal best.
And when you say heal, I've got an idea, but what are you referring to?
I think, of course, it's hard for anyone to heal completely from such a traumatic experience, but just generally being able to move on with their lives and come to peace with the fact that what happened wasn't their fault, but just an event that occurred to them.
Is that a common reaction? They believe they could have done more, that they did something to provoke it or could have done more to stop it?
Yes, definitely. I think a lot of victims feel, or survivors feel, that if they had just not walked in a certain area at night, if they had done all the safety tips that they were supposed to, if they had worn different clothes or not drank alcohol, that something wouldn't have happened to them. But what you find is that that's not the case at all, that you can do everything perfectly right and bad things will still happen, which is also very hard to understand.
It is. I'd like to go back a little further into the two of you. You mentioned how this is something you're passionate about. Clearly, being on campus, this is your third year there, that you're aware of these things firsthand, what you hear. Tell me a little bit about growing up, your households, and even some things that just, you know, contribute to not just wanting to do these entrepreneurial things, but having this both empathy and a definite sense of strength to go ahead and help with a cause like this.
Yeah, I think personally growing up, my parents actually met here, so they're very like aware of this campus. And my dad, when I first came here, he is always buying me the newest pepper spray, or like the most recent thing he bought me were these like knuckles shaped like a cat, where you you put it on your keychain, and then he told me to aim for the eyes. So he's very aware of the things that go on this campus, and I think he always tries to prepare me the best. I think growing up, I grew up in a very safe area, so I didn't personally encounter much crime or acts of violence. But I guess going to a new place and going to specifically a foreign place where you don't know much. Coming to the University of Illinois, I felt less sheltered, and I know that's the case for basically all college campuses. So I think that's the biggest reason of why I wanted to get involved in this cause, because it was kind of something very foreign, and I feel like with a lot of times with these crimes, people don't take precautionary measures until it happens to them. And so that's why I wanted to make an impact on this issue.
How about you, Premika?
I think, like, similar to Kendall, I grew up in a pretty safe place where not a lot of things happened to the people around me. But I still remember coming to college, my parents would, of course, always tell me, stay safe, don't walk home late at night, all the general things that you're supposed to follow. But it really only hit me when my brother, who's older than me, 2 years older, and had been to college, sat me down and told me that it was important to listen to these things, because in general, I feel like parents are always going to be overprotective and tell you to do a lot of stuff. So hearing it from my brother really made it stand out, and he told me how a lot of his friends had, like, been affected by this issue. And personally, like, I've seen people who have been affected too. So seeing that and knowing that this is happening on our campus where we're supposed to feel safe, and knowing that our campus does make people feel unsafe, it made me want to do something about it, because I think your university at least should be a place where you feel comfortable and you aren't scared walking home.
I think that's well said. And I've been out of the university for over 20 years now, 25 years. And it's a big place. And I grew up originally in the city. I had worked downtown. I was younger with my dad. He had taught me to, you know, watch my back, some things like that. And I remember being there, just having a heightened awareness. But also I remember seeing a lot of people walking the streets, which I think is very common, you know, in all campuses. And I live in a campus town now here in Baltimore. Just spent last weekend up in Boston, where my daughter's going to school, which is, you know, one giant campus.